Like most people, when they first hear the word cannabis, you sort of think, oh, come on. But then the thing is, when you start looking at the science behind it, the hardcore clinical data, you're just saying, yeah, look, it makes sense. Particular patient groups were accessing these products illicitly and self-treating and were getting good results. What terrifies docs is the fact is that you've got mothers having to buy this stuff from some street corner from, you know, whoever, who have grown this stuff illicitly, and they're supposed to be giving that to sick kids. I mean, it just seemed completely illogical. That was the current state of play in this country. It's been allowed in Canada for many years now. Many countries in Europe, 27 states in the US now allow access to medicinal cannabis. So this was all going on and Australia was still not allowing these products. How could this regulatory be done in this country? What are the existing laws? What needs to be changed to move it forward? Because we already had laws in place on a federal level for manufacturing of narcotics. So really there was just some gaps in terms of being allowed to cultivate and manufacture cannabis here in this country. So it was a matter of moving cannabis from being a prohibited substance to a controlled substance. Schedule 9 is where cannabis sat, and that was a prohibited substance. So what happened in November is on a federal level, the TGA rescheduled it to a Schedule 8. So that puts it into a controlled substance. That then said that it could be used for therapeutic purposes. Docs could prescribe it, clinical trials could be done more easily in this space, and essentially that was the turning point.
Yeah, as far as I know, I'm the only person that is doing research here in Western Australia, in cannabis, yes. We hope with our study to provide further evidence that this is a good way to treat patients. For my entire career, I was focusing in lipids, role of lipids in cell biology, especially in diseases like cancer. Cannabis and cannabinoids have a structure that is very similar to this lipid, and this similarity struck me from the very beginning of my career. But I initially discovered these lipids that are present in high amount in cancer cells. Now the cannabinoids have a structure that is very similar and is antagonist, so it blocks the activity of this receptor. This antagonist activity has been exploited as potential anti-cancer.
They're starting to see, some of the researchers have seen that where they've used medicinal cannabis for treating the chemo-induced nausea, for certain types of cancer, they've actually noticed the cancer reducing in size. If you can potentially knock some cancers, that would be just astronomical.
This is ongoing. There are many studies now ongoing in the clinics, and I hope this would be soon will confirm the potential of these cannabinoids and cannabis extract in the drug treatment, especially in conjunction with other known treatments.
So if they're on some of the opiates, cannabis seems to work synergistically. So what they can do is they can pull their opiate levels right down by supplementing in with the cannabis. So they're getting better symptom management, better quality of life outcomes because they're not getting all those necessary side effects of the opiates. What we're seeing in Canada, a lot of substitution is now going on where they're replacing a lot of that opiate intake with cannabis and getting much better outcomes. So this is the number one use of medicinal cannabis anyway.
Cannabinoids have many effects. They may have effect on pain. They may have also effect on many side effects like vomiting and nausea. So that this is can improve the well-being because of this concomitant activity.
The federal government has now eased up on their timeline for importing overseas product for supplying to patients, which is absolutely fantastic. Hopefully we'll start seeing within just a couple of months product now coming in from overseas, docs being authorised, and we actually start flowing these medicines to patients. The only slight issue that we would have, I guess, at the moment in terms of patient access is the fact that docs have to go through an approval process on a federal level. They also have to go through an approval process on a state level. But the problem is with this duplicity of approval process, it takes time. So we would like to see the system evolve over time where there are certain GPs, if they show they have the relevant expertise, to be able to say, look, I treat this many pain patients, I have a good knowledge of that particular area, that they could too write out scripts for medical cannabis as well. So I think Australia is going to be one of the leaders, to be honest, in the research of in the cannabis space.
Yeah, we're doing very good research, and I think I found many opportunities here. There might seem people think it's practice isolated and with less opportunities, but I can say this is not true. It's a wrong attitude. I think there are many, many opportunities as a good environment. Our work is very expensive. We need funds, we need support to do work in the lab. It's not so easy. So to find some kind of support, and this is makes your research faster and better.
WA could be very well placed for companies to produce and manufacture here in this state. We have such a vast range of different growing climates here. Certainly the southwest, it would be considered one of the more traditional kind of growing area, I guess you would say. And certainly with the support of the WA government, which we're seeing, they seem to be supporting that these activities will occur here as well. So that's very promising.